Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Nature of Plants, An Introduction to How Plants Work, by Craig N. Huegel, narrated by Tom Parks. Publisher's note, in this audio edition, you will hear references to tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. Plants have always been an important part of my life. Many of my earliest memories center on the garden, and it is a passion that has endured. I'm a gardener first and a biologist second. I find plants to be fascinating, both for their beauty and their underlying biology. To me, these two aspects cannot be separated from each other. The beauty of plants is easily lost when they are distilled down to just the nuts and bolts of science, but understanding the basics of plant biology is necessary to fully appreciate what makes them special. My appreciation for plants has been greatly increased by understanding how they work, how they function internally, and how they relate to one another and the world around them. And all of this has made me a better gardener. Gardeners do not need to know everything about the biology of plants to be effective, but understanding some of the basics is especially helpful. We need to know enough to understand what plants need to achieve their optimal growth, to reproduce, and to coexist with their neighbors and their enemies. Before we purchase a new plant to add to our landscape, we need to be able to honestly evaluate whether it is the right specimen to make the transition from potted plant to plant community member. We need to understand how it will relate to the growing conditions of our landscape. And when something doesn't go right after we've planted it, we need to understand why. We don't have to become scientists to be good gardeners, but we should understand the science that's been produced by others. After all, we are dealing with finely tuned organisms that have been evolving intricate bells and whistles for nearly a half billion years. The diversity of plants is astounding. Botanists estimate that there are nearly 288,000 unique species of plants in existence today. Nearly 90% of these are flowering plants. The rest are mostly mosses, ferns, and conifers. Nearly every color, shape, and growth form exists to meet the aesthetic needs of a modern-day gardener. This aspect is the one that calls most of us to work with plants. It's the underlying biological part that has largely been ignored. Aristotle believed that plants had the lowest kind of soul because they seemed incapable of any of the behaviors observed in animals. This attitude has largely persisted in our collective psyche. Plants may be interesting to look at, and they are definitely biologically necessary. But most of us view them as somewhat boring, about as exciting as watching grass grow. Many of us who garden often fall into this trap. We purchase plants, dig holes, water them, and give them a jolt of fertilizer before largely leaving them to live life on their own. If our plants fail to prosper, we water and fertilize them again, based on a belief that these simple solutions are all that plants really require. If our plants die, we buy new ones or conclude that our failure was somehow due to the plants themselves, and we then buy a different kind to fill the void in our landscape. When we purchase or adopt an animal for our household, we usually do things much differently. Prior to bringing the animal home, we do some research on what our new addition will need from us and what we should expect from it. We take steps to prepare our home to receive it, and we study its acclimation into our household, prepared to call in a veterinarian, a trainer, or some other expert should anything appear out of order. After all, we may reason, animals are complicated and plants are simple. The truth is, the plants are far more complex than we have traditionally perceived them to be. In some ways, they are even more complex than animals. Animals have life relatively easy. For one thing, they can move to more favorable conditions when life treats them harshly. This ability to move gives them lots of options that plants do not have. Once a plant's seed or spore germinates, its only choice is to make do with what it's been given. Plants must do everything animals do while remaining in the same location for the duration of their lives. They have had to develop intricate adaptations and behaviors over the more than 500 million years they have been on land. That's a long track record of success. They seem simple to us because what they do is largely done sight unseen and at a rate of speed that is hardly noticeable. This is not a book to teach you the fundamentals of plant biology, though it might do some of that in a roundabout way. Brian Capon has written a useful botany textbook for the general public, Botany for Gardeners, 1990, and there is no need to duplicate his effort. This book is intended to teach gardeners and others who love plants how to apply plant biology to make their work with plants more successful and to unlock some of the mysteries in a practical way so that more gardens thrive and fewer plants die. Along the way, I hope it also gives you a deeper appreciation for how intricate and interesting plants are. As a botany professor and a lifelong gardener, I want to better merge these two disciplines. Too many gardening books focus on what plants do for us, as if their sole purpose centered on their appearance and utility. My desire is that we look at plants without this anthropomorphic bias and see them for their own intrinsic value. This book is an outgrowth of both my classroom and gardening experiences. As a plant biology professor, I routinely take complicated concepts and translate them for my non-botanist students. I also try to focus on those things that I believe might be relevant to their future relationships with plants. My students are not interested in memorizing the intricacies of the Calvin cycle, for example, but they need to know how it works and why it's important. Very few of us, in fact, will ever be asked to sketch out the complex steps in photosynthesis, even though our lives depend on those chemical equations. Understanding the basics of how plants work is important, and that is the approach I've taken in the chapters that follow for all the aspects of plant biology that I've included. When we understand plants, we understand the foundation of life on Earth. I also wish to leave you with an appreciation for how plants work from the perspective of a fellow plant lover. I came to love plants for their beauty and their practicality. I have slowly evolved to love plants simply for their plantness. Plants intrigue me because they are plants. I've come to look at them with a broader perspective than I once did. They have their own stories to tell. This book is my way of sharing their stories. I hope it will add to your love of plants and enhance your joy in working with them. Gardening is more than a hobby to me, as it is to most of the real gardeners I know. For me, my plants are no different than my animal pets. I feel joy in their successes and sorrow in their failures. Though they may depend on me for their daily survival, I depend on them for mine. I do not know what my life would become without my plants and landscape to putter around in. It is my hope that these chapters will add to your gardening joy and enhance the relationships you have with the plants you live with. As the French Impressionist painter Claude Monet once wrote, "My garden is my most beautiful masterpiece." May all of our landscapes be works of enduring and living art. Introduction: Where Plants Come From. Scientists estimate that plants first adapted to life on land about 500 million years ago, emerging from Ordovician oceans after evolving the capacity to do so from certain types of green algae. Before this, the upland portion of our planet was mostly rock. Soils were beginning to form from the action of erosion and the invasion of fungi and their later partnership with green algae and cyanobacteria, lichens. Fungi can extract minerals from bare rock, and the green algae and lichens can photosynthesize. Cyanobacteria can capture atmospheric nitrogen and convert it to the type of nitrogen needed for life. Together, fungi and lichens initiate soil formation in places where no soil exists. Though the fossil evidence is poor, it seems that fungi, and then lichens, were preparing soil for at least 50 million years before any type of plant crawled out of the ocean to share this ancient landmass referred to as Pangaea. The earliest land plants were simple and looked similar to colonial green algae, the stringy types that are often present at the edges of ponds and other water bodies. They did not have a vascular system, the circulatory system used by most of their descendants to move water, minerals, and simple sugars throughout their bodies. Without roots, the earliest land plants simply absorbed water directly through their one-cell thick leaves and stems. Sugars produced in photosynthesis would not have to be transported because each cell would be doing its own synthesizing. Non-vascular plants still exist in nearly every aquatic and non-aquatic habitat on Earth. We know them as bryophytes, mosses, liverworts, and hornworts, and they remain vital components of the world's flora. Modern bryophytes have evolved to meet the demands of a changing world, but they remain relatively simple compared to the vascular plants that evolved from them. The ferns, gymnosperms, conifers and their relatives, and flowering plants that are the focus of most gardening efforts. The evolution of vascular plants produced real roots and allowed for the development of complex above-ground structures because now there was a circulatory system that allowed for the transport of everything the plant needed throughout its entire body. This adaptation opened the door to many complex structures and behaviors. But it also allowed for the possibility of many things that could go wrong. Simple is sometimes just fine. Ask anyone who once worked on their own car before the advent of engine computers and electronics. At their core, vascular plants have retained the simplicity of their ancient ancestors. They need sunlight to photosynthesize, and the basic C3 pathway that all non-vascular algal plants use still forms the core photosynthetic pathway of all their descendants. Though many higher plants have improved on this model and added a few bells and whistles to modernize it a bit, very little at the core of the process has changed. Plants need water to complete all the major functions necessary for life. They respire. They require certain elements to maintain a base metabolism. And when conditions are right, they grow, reproduce, and eventually die. The bryophytes of 500 million years ago initiated an upward ladder of plant complexity starting with ferns. Ferns and their relatives, horsetails, whisk ferns, club mosses, spike mosses, and quillworts were the dominant plants during the Carboniferous period, approximately 300 million years ago. Many of our richest coal deposits were produced by these fern forests, and a huge diversity of species existed, including many as large as modern-day trees. Scientists believe that the Earth was generally warmer and more humid during this time. Ferns and their relatives made one especially significant change from their mossy ancestors. They developed a simple vascular system. By developing true roots, they could pull water, with all its dissolved nutrients, up from the soil or off a rock. The stems could then take the mineral-rich water and transport it into the fronds. Likewise, the chloroplasts inside the green fronds and stems could take the sun's energy, convert it to glucose, and then send those simple sugars throughout the entire plant. Unlike bryophytes, not every part of the plant needed to absorb water and perform photosynthesis. They could have specialized parts in their overall structure. Ferns could now grow to be much larger than their mossy predecessors. All of this made for huge advances in the plant world, and it became the new model for every other type of plant to follow. From this point forward, all plants would have specialized roots, stems, and leaves. Ferns and their relatives, however, still rely on relatively archaic methods for reproduction. Like the bryophytes that came before them, they produce spores instead of seeds, and they produce them in structures that rely solely on the wind to move them to new locations. To be fair, this was the most effective means of dispersal at the time of their evolution. There simply were no pollinators present in the Carboniferous period. There were plenty of insects, but there was nothing for them to pollinate. Wind has its limitations, especially in warm and humid air. Plants, like most of us, wish our children well as they move out into the world and become their own masters. We just don't wish for them to live at home their entire lives. Nearby is fine, but on their own and independent of us. Windy days effectively move spores long distances, but plants have no control over the wind, and relying on chance is never the most efficient strategy for success. Ferns and other fern-like plants maintained another characteristic of the bryophytes that also limited their reproduction. They required a film of water to get their gametes together for fertilization. Like the bryophytes, fern sperm is flagellated and can only reach a fern egg by swimming to it. They are completely dependent on the weather around them to produce new ferns. Reproduction cannot occur during periods of drought unless a layer of dew is produced overnight. More often than not, fern reproduction requires extended periods of moisture produced by rain and high humidity. This worked fine during the Carboniferous period, but became more limiting as the Earth's climate became less tropical. Today, most of these plants are found in tropical and semi-tropical areas or in the vicinity of wetlands or seasonally wet habitats. The incredible diversity of ferns and related plants found in the Carboniferous period has significantly declined. Spores aren't all bad. They've worked successfully for hundreds of millions of years. Because they are so small, they can be produced in huge numbers with little investment on the part of the parents. Their minute size enables them to remain lightweight and capable of long-distance movements. They also can be quite resistant to temperature extremes and desiccation. The downside to spores is that they contain very little nutrition for the tiny embryonic plant inside. When a spore decides to sprout, the baby plant must find water and nutrients almost immediately if it is to survive its first days. There's little room for error. For that reason, the overwhelming number of spores produced by ferns and mosses perish before the young adult is even noticeable. The evolution of seeds began in the Carboniferous period with the emergence of the so-called seed ferns, but it didn't really reach the advancement seen in more modern plants until the Permian period, approximately 50 million years later. By this time, plants easily recognizable as gymnosperms, conifers, cycads, ginkgos, and neophytes, comprised the dominant plant life. This continued well through the age of the dinosaurs, ending approximately 100 million years later. Dinosaurs existed in a world largely devoid of flowering plants. The great herbivores, so frequently shown in modern film and television, feasted on pine trees, cycads, and the like, and did not encounter flowering plants until sometime late in the Cretaceous period, approximately 90 million years ago. Gymnosperms perfected several significant new features that would become models for all the plants that would follow. Foremost was a reproductive system far less dependent on moisture and better designed to protect the developing embryo. Gymnosperms produced seeds in protective cones. They produced pollen instead of flagellated sperm to fertilize their eggs. And their fertilized seeds contained large stores of nutrients for the developing embryo inside. They could still cast huge quantities of pollen into the air because, like spores, there was little parental investment in producing it. However, they could focus more attention on the seeds, producing just a few in comparison to ferns and mosses, but ensuring that a much higher percentage would actually develop and grow. Seeds were a huge advancement in the evolution of modern plants. For one, the fertilized embryos are encased inside them. Instead of being encapsulated inside a thin casing as spores are, Seeds have both a seed coat and a rich food source to protect and nourish the developing embryonic plant inside. Spores are cast out into the world by their parents with few resources on which to draw. Seeds pamper the infant, protect and nourish it, and give it time to fully develop before it leaves the seed, sprouts, and becomes a functioning juvenile on its own. When the juvenile plant emerges from its seed, it is far more ready to face the world than any plant produced by a spore. It already has the beginning of its roots and stems. It has embryonic leaves, and it often maintains a portion of its original nutrition stores to draw on while its roots fully develop their ability to draw water from the ground. Furthermore, its leaves have the ability to produce new food via photosynthesis. Baby plants produced by seeds start life with an advantage. Producing seeds takes far more investment on the part of the parents, but it ensures a higher rate of survival for their offspring. The production of seeds also creates more opportunity to fine-tune the process of germination. Breaking the dormancy of a spore is a relatively simple process. Mostly, it involves having the right moisture conditions around it. Spores can remain dormant for long periods of time, waiting for just the right moisture conditions to occur. The embryo inside is in a state of suspended animation until then. Seeds, on the other hand, often have more elaborate mechanisms to prevent them from sprouting until everything seems just right. Seeds require some kind of stratification to break their dormancy. Cold, heat, blight, water, abrasion, or combinations of these conditions. By having a seed coat that requires certain conditions to be met before germination will occur, the embryo inside is protected from sprouting under conditions that are less than optimal for them to start life on their own. Seeds also diversify dispersal methods. Whereas the simple, rounded spores of mosses and ferns require an air current to move them away from their parents, wind-dispersed seeds are often aided by the presence of wings to help carry them farther. This was a major advancement, but most seed-producing plants completely abandoned their reliance on wind. They developed other options, and the most significant new vector was movement by animals. When swallowed whole, seeds pass through the digestive tract of animals and are released in their waste as they move about. Animals that make long-distance movements can carry seeds to completely new habitats not already colonized, and the seeds are deposited with their own dollop of fertilizer. The gymnosperms initiated this mode of dispersal, but it was the flowering plants that developed later that perfected it. Gymnosperms were also the first plants to truly protect their offspring during early development. They did this by producing their eggs inside rigid cones and then surrounding them inside these cones until the embryos were fully developed. While seed ferns merely held their primitive seeds inside open, cup-like structures, gymnosperms encased them in woody, often spiny scales. In modern-day pines, for example, it can take more than a year for fertilization to occur once the pollen is captured inside the egg-producing cone. Then, it may take another 12 to 16 months for the seeds to develop and mature. For all this time, everything is well protected inside the cone. The spores of ferns and mosses are in no way so well guarded. Last, gymnosperms do not require water for fertilization to take place. Their sperm are encased inside the pollen grains, and the pollen is dispersed in the wind. Like spores, pollen is lightweight and capable of long-distance movement under the right environmental conditions. The pollen of gymnosperms comes surrounded by two wings for extra buoyancy in their aerial travels. But the sperm inside does not require a film of water on which to travel to the egg. Some primitive gymnosperms still have flagellated sperm that evidence their evolutionary connection to the ferns and mosses, but they don't use them in fertilization. Their pollen actually creates a tube that burrows toward the unfertilized egg and deposits the sperm next to it. The evolution of gymnosperms created an intricate new level of complexity not seen in plants previously. Reproduction was fine-tuned to increase the likelihood of success. Sperm now had to have a burrow created for it to reach the unfertilized egg. Females now had more control over which sperm would do the fertilization, and the entire process was less haphazard. Some gymnosperms, the conifers and ginkgos, also evolved the ability to produce wood and thereby increase their girth. True wood did not exist in the tree ferns or any of the other fern-like plants that compose the forests of the Carboniferous period. Wood and increased girth allowed for upward growth not previously possible. Pines, Pinus species, cedars, Juniperus species, spruces, Piceus species, cypress, Taxodium species, and the like can reach mature heights of more than 100 feet, something previously impossible. Mature redwoods, Sequoia sempervirens, and sequoias, Sequoia dendrum giganteum, routinely exceed 350 feet. Wood permits a great many functions. It provides structure, allows other plants to attach and grow, and adds structural complexity to plant communities. Gymnosperms dominated the Earth's upland habitats for at least 150 million years, sharing the area with dinosaurs until late in the Cretaceous period, approximately 100 million years ago. Relatively recent information gleaned from the fossil record demonstrates that flowering plants emerged in the prehistoric flora well before an asteroid struck the Yucatan Peninsula and changed everything with a global mass extinction event. The large-scale habitat changes that followed this asteroid strike allowed the remaining plants to quickly evolve, and what evolved were flowering plants. More than 350,000 species of flowering plants have emerged in the last 100 million years, more than all other plant types combined. Our modern world is completely dominated by plants that produce flowers. Flowers provided plants with an ability no other plant possessed, a means of pollination not reliant on wind power, but rather facilitated by the movement of pollinating animals. Wind had worked rather efficiently up to this time, but using animals to transfer seeds and pollen opened a new door that has proven extremely effective. With the evolution of flowers came an explosion in the evolution of pollinators, especially among pollinating insects. Modern-day bees and pollinating wasps evolved from predatory species. Prior to flowers, there was no need to collect, feed on, and disseminate pollen. Evolutionary ecologists believe that butterflies evolved from ancient caddisflies, the group that includes bagworms, at the same time flowering plants began to proliferate. There is no doubt that the evolution of flowers coincided with the evolution of pollinators, and that this relationship continues and defines many of our modern gardening practices. Pollinators allowed for selective pollination. Plants could develop complex relationships with their pollinators, and pollinators could become extremely specialized. The element of chance that was the driving force behind wind pollination was largely circumvented. Of course, all of this meant that plants became ever more complex, and complexity brings both benefits and difficulties. Suffice it to say that since nearly 85% of the world's plants produce flowers, and nearly 85% of those are animal-pollinated, this is a very effective strategy. Pollinated flowers produce fruit, and that too was a major advance over the cones produced by gymnosperms. While gymnosperms produce seeds protected beneath the covering of a hardened scale, the seeds themselves are mostly reliant on wind for dispersal. There are some exceptions, but pines, spruces, and others in the conifer family produce seeds covered by a light diaphanous wing. When the seeds are ripe, the scales of the cone open, releasing the winged seeds to float away in the wind. Flowering plants, such as the grasses and orchids, still rely on wind power to disperse their seeds. But the majority of flowering plants use animals. The evolution of fruit coincides with the evolution of fruit-eating animals, frugivores. Producing succulent, high-energy fruit like apples, Malus pumila, and peaches, Prunus persica, takes a lot of energy on the part of the parent plant. That expenditure of energy is justified when it serves to attract animals that eat the fruit and carry the seeds to distant places before depositing them. Just as flowers and pollinators have been able to develop complex relationships over time, so have fruit-bearing plants and frugivores. Not all fruit is equally attractive to every animal. Flowering plants' ability to target specific groups of animals with their fruit meant that the plants could become extremely discerning in the ways seeds would be dispersed. Fruit is not only supremely edible, but in many cases it is also extremely good at protecting the developing embryos inside. In fact, the relationship between those embryos and the surrounding fruit is quite complex. As the embryos develop, they release a suite of hormones that influence the development and ripening process of the fruit itself. When the embryos are young, the surrounding fruit is typically hard, bitter, and largely inedible. In this condition, the seeds enclosed inside are protected from danger. As the embryos inside the seeds get closer to maturity, however, it is in the plant's best interest to speed the ripening of their fruit and increase its palatability. The seeds of a green tomato, Solanum lycopersicum, are not mature enough to sprout and grow into new tomato plants. Most animals wait until the fruit is at the peak of ripeness before consuming it. In this way, the fruit of most flowering plants is both a protective vessel and a dispersal mechanism. We garden with plants that have been evolving for hundreds of millions of years. At each step, they've taken up the evolutionary ladder. From bryophytes to modern-day flowering plants, their complexity has increased. For the most part, plants can take care of themselves. They don't really need us to coddle them. At the same time, we can't pretend that they are simple. Plants challenge us to understand them if we are going to treat them respectfully and ultimately carve out a space in our landscape that will satisfy both of us. Chapter 1. Light. The miracle of photosynthesis. Well before plants, the Earth's oceans teemed with organisms that had evolved the ability to capture the energy of the sun and convert it to a simple 6-carbon sugar known as glucose. It is generally agreed that the first organisms capable of photosynthesis evolved more than 3 billion years ago among certain types of bacteria. Some of these, like the cyanobacteria, also developed the ability to convert atmospheric nitrogen to forms useful to cellular functions like protein production. When people warn me about the dangers of bacteria, I have to remind them that all life on Earth owes its very existence to the presence of bacteria, despite the few that cause disease. The evolution of photosynthetic pathways that used water and produced oxygen as a waste product came a bit later. The date is the subject of much discussion among the experts. Several different lines of geological evidence indicate, however, that oxygen began to accumulate in the atmosphere about 2.4 billion years ago. This suggests that the modern photosynthetic pathways used by plants and their ancestors evolved much earlier. Atmospheric oxygen can't increase without a coetaneous decrease in CO2. So we know that the sequestration of carbon that led to our modern-day fossil fuel industry began several billion years ago. Life as we know it has been made possible by the evolution of photosynthesis. Though there are various specialized organisms that don't deploy that process, animal life is dependent on plants, and plants are dependent on photosynthesis for every aspect of their life. this miracle of life is quite simplistic on the surface. Though the various steps inside the equation get rather complex, the overall equation is easily comprehended. 6 CO2, carbon dioxide, plus 12 H2O, water, plus sunlight, equals C6H12O6, glucose, plus 6H2O, plus 6O2, oxygen. The carbon dioxide plants need for photosynthesis comes from the atmosphere. It enters the plant through pores in the leaves and green stems called stomata. Water enters the plant through its roots, unless it is a moss or other bryophyte. The photosynthetic process takes place during daylight hours, with a few exceptions, as sunlight strikes the plant. Plants take the carbon dioxide existing in the atmosphere and the water that they already contain in their cells, and use the energy of the sun to split the carbon dioxide into free oxygen, while taking the now free carbon to make glucose. The oxygen, so vital to plant and animal respiration, is actually a byproduct of the plant's need for carbon to survive and grow. Solar energy is converted to chemical energy, and this chemical energy fuels all higher plant and animal life on Earth. When someone tells you that sugar is bad for you, realize that all life on Earth is dependent on the sugar produced by photosynthetic plants. It's the other types of sugars and how we use them that are negatively affecting our health. Photosynthesis is possible because of a complex molecule known as chlorophyll alpha. Chlorophyll alpha actually starts the photosynthetic process. It is the molecule that sunlight has to hit in order to split carbon dioxide into oxygen and carbon molecules. And it's the site that then takes this extra solar energy and eventually stores it in the chemical bonds of simple and complex sugars. When we talk of getting a sugar high from eating too many sweets, we are really getting that high from sunlight. Though other chlorophylls have been found in plants, they merely supplement the ability of chlorophyll alpha to perform its job. All plants and their precursors have taken this chlorophyll molecule and packed it into storage bodies known as chloroplasts. Each chloroplast contains many flattened disks known as thylakoids, in which the chlorophyll is stored. And these thylakoids are stacked into cylindrical silos known as grana. Grana are then interconnected into distribution centers known as antenna complexes. The material surrounding the grana is called the stroma. Light strikes the chlorophyll in the chloroplasts and initiates photosynthesis. Oxygen is released from the initial reactions in the thylakoids, the Calvin cycle or C3 pathway. Glucose is produced in the second part of the reaction in the stroma. Despite all the complexities of turning solar energy into carbohydrates, the actual structure that produces it is rather simple. Thousands of molecules of chlorophyll alpha, collected into hundreds of flattened disks, stacked into tens of cylinders, and then interconnected with one another within each chloroplast, and surrounded by a matrix of stroma. Every cell in a green leaf or stem may have a dozen chloroplasts. The total number of chloroplasts in even a small photosynthetic plant is mind-boggling. In typical plants, the chloroplasts required for photosynthesis are concentrated just below the leaf and green stem surfaces. These so-called C3 plants use an enzyme known as rubisco to initiate the photosynthetic process. The evolution of rubisco and this system of chlorophyll, chloroplasts, thylakoids, grana, antenna complexes, and stroma has worked for millions of years without any real modifications. You don't need to know the many intermediate steps of photosynthesis to grasp the overall picture. The important message is that sunlight provides the energy that is needed, and carbon dioxide provides the oxygen required for plant and animal respiration, and the carbon required for plant growth. Without water, none of this would be possible. life as we generally know it, is run on the energy supplied by the sun and harnessed by the ultimate solar panels in the universe, located in chloroplasts. Sunlight strikes the Earth as photons, packets of electromagnetic energy whose total energy depends on its wavelength. Waves with lower amplitudes and wider spacing between their crests carry far less energy than the taller, closely spaced ones. You see the same effect if you spend a day at the beach. It is much easier to stand in the water when the waves striking you are slow and rolling than after a speeding boat races by and magnifies the wave heights. You can easily feel the energy difference between these two types of waves. Energy emitted by the sun is composed of a broad spectrum of wavelengths, and all life on Earth is constantly being struck by all of them. The wavelengths somewhere in the middle of this broad spectrum are known as visible light. It is the portion we see with our eyes. We see it as a rainbow of colors when it is passed through a prism or through water droplets produced in a rainstorm. Visible light is also the portion of the spectrum that plants use for photosynthesis. In a way, we have evolved together. Other portions of the solar spectrum are not useful to this process. The sun emits longer wavelengths in the form of infrared radiation that some insects and birds can see, and even longer wavelengths in the form of radar, AM and FM radio, television, and AC circuit waves. These lower-energy electromagnetic solar waves cannot be seen by us or used by plants for photosynthesis, but they can be felt as warmth. The thermal portion of sunlight comes from infrared wavelengths striking the Earth's surface. The longer, lower-amplitude waves pass more easily through clouds in the atmosphere than do the higher wavelengths. Therefore, we can feel warm even on a cloudy day. Because these wavelengths are lower in energy, however, they do not carry the energy needed to initiate photosynthesis. Visible light packs enough of a wallop when it hits a chlorophyll molecule to split the carbon dioxide and water molecules necessary to start the process. Infrared and other less energetic wavelengths just can't do it. They warm the plant, but they do not provide it with the energy needed to survive. The solar-generated electromagnetic spectrum also contains wavelengths with more energy than that contained in visible light. Ultraviolet radiation, X-rays, and gamma rays constantly pass through the Earth's atmosphere, too. We don't see them either, but we see and feel the effects of their presence when we get sunburned after spending time outdoors without protection. Clouds deflect some of these rays, so we are less likely to burn when it is overcast than when it is not, but it is just as easy to burn on a cold day as it is on a warm one. Too much exposure to these high-intensity rays is damaging to our health. Ultraviolet light, X-rays, and gamma rays are too energetic to work with chlorophyll molecules in photosynthesis, and can damage plant tissues in the same way that they damage ours. We cover ourselves in lightweight clothes, broad-brimmed hats, and sunscreen, if we are prudent, when we spend time working outdoors under the full sun. Plants do much the same thing if they are adapted to thrive in sunny locations. They cover their leaves with hairs, trichomes, and waxy cuticles. And they produce carotenoid pigments to serve as a sort of sunscreen. Carotenoids are the orange, red, and yellow pigments that become apparent in the fall as leaves begin to turn color. Actually, they are present at all times. Their colors are masked during the growing season by the chlorophyll. Carotenoids cannot fully protect plants that are poorly adapted to large amounts of ultraviolet light. We receive sunburns and turn red. Plants turn a sickly yellow as their chlorophyll gets destroyed faster than they can manufacture more. Though sunlight contains a very broad spectrum of wavelengths, only the relatively narrow band that we call visible light is useful to photosynthesis. Even within this narrow band, however, plants are selective. Not all the colors of the rainbow are equally effective, and some portions are not used at all. Chlorophyll alpha, the molecule solely responsible for driving the photosynthetic process, reacts primarily to visible light in the orange-red portion of the spectrum, and less so in the area at the division between violet and blue. It does not respond to the part of spectrum that includes green and yellow. If you were to grow a plant using a specialized bulb or filter that included only this portion of the visible spectrum, your plants would not be able to photosynthesize and would quickly die, just as if they had been kept in the dark. In fact, we think of plants and chlorophyll as being green in color, when in fact they are green only because they do not absorb the green portion of the visible spectrum. They reflect it back to our eyes. Chlorophyll is not a green pigment. It is a green light reflector. While chlorophyll alpha drives the process of photosynthesis, additional chlorophylls and pigments supplement the process. To date, scientists have found three other chlorophylls, essentially identical to chlorophyll alpha, except for small changes to a single side chain in its molecular structure. Of these, only chlorophyll beta occurs in true plants with chlorophyll alpha. The evolution of a second type of chlorophyll has allowed plants to capture a bit more of the visible light spectrum and use it in photosynthesis. Chlorophyll beta is able to use the energy of a slightly different part of the blue and orange-red spectrum and pass it on to chlorophyll alpha to make it more efficient. Additionally, the carotenoid pigments that double as a sunscreen also capture parts of the blue spectrum not captured by either of the chlorophylls. Like chlorophyll beta, they take this energy, pass it on to chlorophyll alpha, and increase its efficiency. To summarize, plants are capable of photosynthesizing only within the red, orange, and violet, blue segments of the visible light spectrum. Specialized bulbs for use in indoor situations take advantage of this and maximize light in these areas while minimizing light in the green, yellow range. Not all light is created equal. Light comes as wavelengths with different energy signatures, and only a very narrow part of the light generated by the sun fits the needs of a plant's chlorophyll molecule to generate the complex processes of photosynthesis. It is a lock-and-key approach, and the key is highly specialized. After several billion years of evolution, we shouldn't expect anything less intricate. The process of photosynthesis is indeed a miracle. Plants feed on light and use it to grow. Therefore, light, or more accurately, a very narrow portion of it, is plant food. Fertilizers aren't. When we fertilize our plants, it is equivalent to humans taking a multivitamin. A good fertilizer supplies the elements plants need to carry on the many enzymatic reactions involved with photosynthesis, or to keep their cells functioning in top condition. Sunlight, however, provides the carbon molecules that produce simple sugars, which eventually get made into more plant tissue. New plant tissue is produced by the sun and the CO2 in the atmosphere. When we understand this, we can better grasp the very real importance of providing our plants with the diet of sunlight they need to remain healthy. Just like animals, plants have baseline metabolisms. Some require large amounts of sunlight to function properly, and others do just fine with less. The plants of open pastures and deserts, for example, have evolved to live under full sunlight. They consume large quantities every day, and they begin to decline when given less. Plants adapted to grow in the understory of dense forests, however, adapt by slowing their metabolisms down and feeding far less ravenously on sunlight to stay fit. While some plants can adjust to slightly more or less sunlight than their optimum, most can't, and their decline is either slow and hardly noticeable or quick and obvious. If you put a moth orchid, Phalaenopsis species, or a begonia, Begonia species, under full sun, its leaves will soon scorch, and its death will swiftly follow. If you subject your turf grass to the dense shade of a large canopy tree, it will eventually weaken and die, regardless of how much water and fertilizer you apply to it. Carbon is the building block of life, and it comes from the atmosphere, harnessed by photosynthesis. Like animals, plants use their food to support every aspect of their life requirements, and they dole it out for their various needs based on a hierarchy of importance. First, they use the sunlight they receive to support their core metabolism. After that, they use it to grow and then to reproduce. That simply makes sense. Here is an apt analogy. If you've ever lived in sub-zero temperatures, you understand frostbite. As your exposure to cold increases, the first symptoms appear in the appendages and extremities, fingers, toes, ears, and the tip of your nose. Such things are not necessary to preserve your life. Your brain and heart, which are important, are the last to go before death. Plants function the same way when confronted with inadequate light. When given a starvation diet of light, they will maintain their core life functions and give up the less necessary ones. Confronted with inadequate light conditions, plants will first abandon their inclination to reproduce. Why bring children into a world with no resources for them? Flowering and fruiting are the least of a plant's worries when light is limited. Even so-called shade-tolerant plants need sufficient light to flower. And a lack of flowering is often the first indication that you are light-starving your plants. I have made this mistake so often in my own gardening experience that I've lost count. Perhaps the best recent example is with a small cluster of sweet shrub, Calycanthus floridus, that I planted more than 20 years ago beneath the shade of two deciduous canopy trees. Where I live in central Florida, sweet shrub is about 150 miles south of its natural range, so I believed I was making conditions easier for it by protecting it from our more intense sun. I was not. For more than two decades, these sweet shrubs went through their annual cycle of leafing out in the spring and going deciduous in the winter. They even grew a bit, but they never flowered. During these years, I attributed all of this to the fact that our winters were not cold enough to stimulate flowering. But then the canopy trees were taken down for other horticultural reasons. The next spring, the tiny patch of sweet shrub burst into bloom. Its diet of sunlight had been increased, and it now had enough energy to do more than simply survive. The second thing a light-starved plant will do is fail to grow. If the most important thing is to preserve its core metabolism and survive, there is no sense in becoming larger and requiring more energy. A plant will first give up sex. Then it will fail to grow. Though growing toward the light may eventually allow it to increase its intake of sunlight, it still requires energy to grow that way. And this trade-off is seen every day in most landscapes. If a plant has enough light to satisfy its core metabolic needs, it can use the extra for growth. If there is more sunlight above it in the canopy, it will grow taller to reach it, even if that means sacrificing girth and strength. If the nearest source of light is to one side or the other, it will grow sideways to reach it, even if that makes it unbalanced and more prone to toppling over. When we place plants in an adequate light, they will try to correct the problem if they can. If the light is too inadequate, however, they will simply shut down and not get larger. I have three fringe trees, Chionanthus virginicus, in my landscape, the last two purchased at the same time and of the same size when planted almost a decade ago. I planted both in the backyard, but one was in a sizable light gap and the other was deeper into the canopy of my existing woodland. The shade-planted specimen bloomed the year I planted it, but has never done so since, nor has it grown. This past year, it lost nearly all its main stem and sprouted weakly from the bottom of the trunk. It is slowly dying, but I have no place to move it to. The one planted in the sunnier spot blooms profusely each spring and has more than tripled in size. Fertilizer and water will not correct inadequate light. Photosynthesis requires water and CO2. Both occur equally in sunny and shady landscapes, all else being equal. What is not present is the required energy to drive the photosynthetic process, the food that feeds the plants. Plants that fare well in low light generally do so by evolving a much lower metabolism than others. They are slow growers, and they use the energy they receive sparingly. Most do not flower profusely or produce a lot of fruit. Some do so only in alternate years or even more sporadically than that. Some have adapted so well to a low-light diet that they can't handle higher levels. The stimulation of higher light levels is actually lethal. Other plants simply make the adjustment. They survive and flower and grow, but they do so at a much slower rate that fits their lower light diet. Our Simpson stoppers, Mercianthus fragrans, are a classic example of the ability some plants have to adjust. In its typical South Florida habitat, Simpson stopper is an understory subcanopy tree, and it resides there beneath an evergreen overstory that shades it all year. The two Simpson stoppers planted in our wooded backyard are beautiful specimens, but they produce few flowers or fruit. The half-dozen planted along the street as a screen flower profusely twice a year and produce copious amounts of fruit. Plants can survive in adequate sunlight, but they can't reach their full potential in such conditions. They also can't store energy to use when faced with a catastrophic situation, such as losing their stem to storm damage or major herbivory.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.